So I'm asked this a lot, and it's usually surprising because it is something very simple that brought me to this. I'm just a regular mom. I've got three kids. They were all in elementary school at the time, maybe one in seventh grade, and I came across an article on Facebook about teen porn consumption. And it was so outrageous to me. It was so unbelievable that I had to do some research. I had to look into this. So I started researching, like literally just that day, sitting there hours of research. And I was just floored by what I saw and floored by how little information and how few resources there were for parents. And I thought, I got to do something. And I had just seen and felt so many issues in the world that I had just let slide, that I had just not gotten on board with, that I had not taken initiative with. And it was like a fire was lit inside me. And I thought, I have to do something. And I started thinking of my kids, and I realized that there was nobody left for my daughter, that there would be nobody left for her who has not been tainted by online pornography or that is not addicted, that these are her future partners and her future spouse. And then I realized it's not enough for me to just protect my own children and educate my own children. I have to get to as many parents as I possibly can to help them teach their kids what true intimacy, what true healthy sexuality is. It was that these very young children, like in middle school, with a vast knowledge, with an intimate knowledge of pornography, of online pornography that most adults have no idea. It's a world that most adults have no idea. We think of pornography as Playboy magazine that maybe our fathers may have looked at, and it's so much more violent. It's so much more graphic than anything that we had thought of. But these kids, that this is, and there are some statistics that say that 90% of kids are getting their sexual education from this because they don't talk, because they don't talk to parents, because the school system is so limited, or they only focus on mechanics and STDs and pregnancy. They're missing this whole huge picture. So of course they have questions. They're going online to find their answers and do their research, and they're coming away with graphic sexual depictions of women in usually in almost always a position of powerlessness. And this is where I was like, these are all of our future lawyers, doctors, policemen, and this is their depiction of women, that these are the next fathers and husbands. And so this is what kind of like shocked me into action and realizing, okay, we got to talk about this. So seeing that this is what kids were just very knowledgeable, and you talk with any, my daughter is now in high school, and talking with what she talks about with her friends, not just boys, but what girls are being exposed to, what they are seeking out is dangerous stuff. And we have got to teach them the opposite. We've got to show them that what's being portrayed in media is usually a very unhealthy message, and that we are more than that, that sex is better than that, it's more amazing than that, than these, base graphic depictions. And so that's what I'm all about. For me, and for what, again, within my research in the last few years, and watching technology just explode, watching the power of this little device that has changed our world more, I would argue, more than the pen, more than the printing press, more than maybe even the wheel, and maybe even more than fire has brought the changes in our relationships, the way we talk to each other, the way we treat each other, how everything is depicted for us. This is one of our greatest teachers, our cell phones and laptops and other internet-enabled devices. It has changed our world so much that we have a lot of catching up to do as parents, that this is why we need to talk about this at an early age to kind of start letting our kids know this is not just the way, this is not the only answer. What's being depicted, this, what's happened, our relationships are not just screen-based. They have provide, these screens have provided us amazing opportunities. Here you and I are talking several states away. This is going to be watched by people all over the country. And so we have these wonderful tools, but there are also major consequences to these tools. One of them being how disconnected we are, that there is a increasing lack of intimacy in our relationships, in between husbands and wives, between parents and children, in our communities. How many kids do we see walking around like this all day?
Mm-hmm.
You know,
pretty much every preteen and teenager. Yep.
Exactly. And for me, that is critical in having these conversations about sex and intimacy, because we are losing so much of that. So we have got to teach intimacy. We've got to teach healthy relationships so that our kids know how to function in the digital world and in real life. And so that's why people might think, well, that's not really sex, but to me it is. That's the building blocks, that intimacy, relationships, friendships, love, caring, kindness. These are those steps. This is that creation. This is part of that big picture that we have to help our children understand and create. So that to me is why we have got to start talking about these topics. I'd say it's really never too early, but it's also never too late. So I don't want anyone to feel like, oh, my child is 11 or 12 and I've missed this. Or when we start talking later on about different topics, it's never too late to start. But also, I don't feel like it's ever too early. Again, because our kids have so much access to so much information, we've got to start young. You know, when I was a younger mom, I was told, you know, wait till they ask you. Wait until they come and bring you their questions. We no longer have that luxury, because we so often parents are putting, you know, iPads and phones into the hands of 2 and 3 year old children, where there are risks of exposure to unhealthy media. We've got to start those conversations early. Having said that, you know, you don't have to start right away with the intimidating topics. You know, people are often really, you know, afraid that they have to go right into the anatomy, right into the mechanics, and you really don't, because again, part of those conversations, and we find that most people don't realize until, you know, I give one of these talks or we start talking, oh, I've already started doing some of those things. Oh, that's right. Okay, I already am modeling a healthy relationship with my partner. Or I've already talked about with my 2 and 3 year old about good touch, bad touch. Or I've talked about the things we can do in private and the things we can do in public. You know, most of us have already had these conversations. So I would say already, again, at that very young age, to just letting them know, I would say first and foremost, just how special they are, how amazing our children are, letting them know over and over again, you're worth protecting. I'm going to protect you. I'm here for you. And your body is an amazing, you know, is an amazing instrument. So that I think is some of those first, that's something that you can even communicate to a 2 and 3 year old. You're special. Your body is special. Talking with dozens and dozens, maybe even hundreds and hundreds of parents, that people have found most beneficial is to start examining those fears. You know, okay, so finding out first, where is that fear coming from? You know, is it from something that I was taught? Is it because something happened in my past? And most of us can kind of come up with, you know, because we kind of will get that we have this fear, this deer in the headlights feeling. But then when you kind of start talking with people, you realize they really are only scared of maybe 3 or 4 topics, maybe even only 1 or 2 topics. So I think the first thing to do is examine your fears. Like, okay, is it that I'm, what am I afraid of? Am I afraid that my child is going to become too curious? Am I afraid that I'm going to say too much? Am I afraid to talk about something that is painful from my past? And really kind of first understand that fear. The next thing I would say that is very beneficial to most people is to talk with somebody about that. Now, if it's something terrible that has happened in our past, you might need a therapist to talk about that. But for a lot of people, talking with a friend or a partner about, okay, where should we begin? Get on the same page with your partner. Okay, this is where I think we need to talk about anatomy first, or I think we need to talk about protective information of helping our kids understand what a good touch is and what a bad touch is. So again, first, you know, and also the benefit of talking with friends and family or a partner is that it gets your language going. Mm-hmm. Then you kind of start getting used to that language and talking. Most people that come into my home, like when we were writing these books, we have a few authors. They, I mean, some of them were were shocked at the discussions that I would have with my children, that I was so open and so frank in talking about something like orgasm or masturbation. But again, that is because we had done this for a very long time and it was very comfortable for me, but that is because I had had years of this language, of that being part of my language. Saying penis and vagina was not intimidating in the least, but that is because I had talked with experts, talked with other parents, talked with so many people. So, and you don't have to do hours and hours of this. Sometimes having a 20, 30-minute discussion with a girlfriend or our partner just gets us ready. You know, oh, okay, boom. That's how we get that language going. I think another important thing is to have a plan. Now, I'm not saying create an event because we don't want to create an event for the child in having a sex talk because we want them to be able to recreate the experience of asking us questions later. But it's more just having kind of in the back of your head, okay, what are we going to talk about today? You know, maybe this is, and this is only going to be maybe a 5 or 10 minute conversation, especially if it is a younger child. So that's not going to take a lot of planning, but having a plan in your head of, okay, I want them to understand these two principles. Maybe I'm going to talk about what's allowed in private and what's allowed in public. You know, that, you know, we're not naked in public, but maybe in our home, it's okay to be naked, you know, or maybe it's okay to be naked in the bathroom or whatever your family values. But again, having that in your head of, okay, what do I want them to understand? For an older child, it might be something bigger, like understanding sexting. But again, I'm having a plan ahead of time of, okay, these are the, you know, two or three principles I want my child to take away from this, to understand at the end of the conversation. So having that plan, something that has helped me personally, that, you know, maybe is not something I've researched with other people, but something with that has helped me personally is having a grand plan of, okay, what do I want my child to take away when they leave my house? What is, as I am helping them along in their sexual development, what is the grand plan? You know, we sometimes get focused on the little to-dos, right? So like we're going to talk about a list of topics later, the to-dos, but we really should focus as well on that to-be. What is the healthy picture I want? And that, I think, to me is less intimidating because then I'm like, that's right. You know, all I'm in the, at the end of the day, I want my child to be a kind, compassionate, hardworking person. They don't have to know every single answer, and neither do I. And that's another principle is for parents is give yourself a break. You're not going to be perfect. I've been doing this for years and I am imperfect. Everybody I know, everybody on my board that has been doing this for a long time, that we've been practicing, that we've talked with other experts, everybody makes mistakes. So let go of perfection and go, that's right. I'm not going to do this perfect, but I'm going to do my best. And my child's going to know that I care about them. And I'm going to let those questions come back to me, and you know, we'll see how it is. Finally, a last piece is, I know again, as I have talked with so many parents, when I hear what they really feel awkward about, it's really very little. And I almost am wondering, not almost, I am wondering a lot, is this something that we have just been taught socially? Oh, this is an awkward conversation, so it's going to be awkward. It's not awkward. It is, to me, that is something that we have been taught in jokes on television shows and in movies. No one wants to talk to their mom or dad about sex. That is something, but as I've had with my experience with other people, that does not have to be our experience at all. This is something that we can look at as an opportunity, not as a have to. Oh, I have to. It's kind of, you know, realizing, okay, am I getting my ideas of awkwardness because I was told by other people that this is going to be awkward, or is it really awkward? There's certain topics that are going to be tough for each, and those are individual for each of us. Most parents I know do not want to talk about something like masturbation, right? That is something that most parents are scared to talk about. But simple things like anatomy, where babies come from, generally, once you get the ball rolling, not awkward at all. And I think that we need to change our mindset. You know, that's right. This is different. Okay, I can do this. This can be fun. This can be interesting. And something that can be incredibly empowering for our kids and can totally bring you and your child closer together. That has been the best thing for me in my experience in doing this over the last few years. And the biggest benefit that I hear from other parents is they had no idea, and I had no idea, how close this would bring my kids and me together. Mm-hmm. Was by having these continued conversations, it created this atmosphere in our home where they knew they could ask me anything. And that has been the most wonderful experience for us, is my kids asking me some amazing questions. I think it needs to be very positive. I often tell people how I don't remember what my mother said about sex, but I remember she talked about it like this. Like it was so amazing and so special. And in some ways you could look back and say that was really cheesy. I don't think so. For me, it was like, oh, like it is, like it's going to be. And I remember that being in contrast often to maybe what I would hear at church or even in school. I had, growing up in California, there was sex ed in seventh grade and I think 10th grade, you had it again. And there was nothing really positive in those conversations. Mm-hmm. It was very like, here it is, you know, just monotone. Okay, this is how it works.
This is the information. Here's the diagram.
Yeah, here's what an STD looks like. Right? So kind of being very positive and just being like, this is amazing. And again, just starting real simple, you know, so that your kids don't feel overwhelmed by it. You don't have to go right to mechanics and penis and vagina. You know, you can talk about healthy relationships and what are you looking for in a relationship and what does your ideal mate look like? Mm-hmm. You know, start with these kind of like fun topics, being really positive. And I think that helps our kids, you know, bring that back to us. So just having just a very positive overall, you know, atmosphere, I think helps letting them know. And then reminding them at the end of these discussions, you can come back and talk to me. If I forgot something or if you have a question later, you know, come back and ask me that question, you know, just kind of keeping that dialogue going where it's informational and where you are being honest and where you are being genuine. A lot of parents think that there's some sort of special structure that they have to follow or that they have to be maybe politically correct. And honestly, what you are modeling in your home is the biggest teacher there is. So whatever you're teaching needs to align with your personal and your cultural values. Mm-hmm. And that those things need to be expressed as well. The expectations that you have in your home, those need to be expressed mm-hmm. as well.
So. And I love that. I think you've also kind of said this, but it sounds like also not only, you know, very positive, but also very loving and also very matter of fact, just, you know, this is how it works. And without this, like, you know, oh, I have to tell you this thing and it's kind of weird, but you know, that kind of like matter of fact thing seems to work pretty well.
Absolutely. And your caring and your kindness are going to come through more than anything. I have seen parents, I have talked with parents who are, they can't help some of their nervousness, but I have seen them behave in such a loving, kind manner. Is that not what we want them to take away from this? Do we really need our children to take away a specific understanding of sexually transmitted diseases and all the, you know, the dozen type of birth control? Or do we need them to come away knowing they can ask me anything mm-hmm. or that I care about them and that I'm not going to judge them, but I am going to just listen kindly and lovingly to their questions and respond honestly? You know,
I love that. Yeah, that is the key thing. That's what, and I love that you said kind of begin with the end in mind. Like, what's the long-term approach here? What do we really want them to get? And that they love us and they can talk to us about anything. That is just golden, isn't it?
Yeah. So I think for, honestly, this is more, I would say almost more for the parent's sake, is to start with that protective information. Mm-hmm. What is going to protect our children first? That's kind of like, in a way, the first line of defense. We want our kids to be protected when they're out away from us, when they're at a babysitter, when they're at daycare, when they're at a friend's house, when they're at a scout activity, when they're at sports. Mm-hmm. So starting very young with helping them understand what good touch, bad touch, helping them understand what a predator looks like, helping them understand boundaries, helping them understand what is okay and what is not okay to be touched and for, you know, affection. One of the principles we talk about in our books is forced affection. That was something that I kind of had to learn about, maybe with like my second child. I didn't get it right away with my first child. We would always say, "Well, go give grandma a hug. Go give, you know." And if they didn't want to, we would still kind of like nudge them and kind of push that on them. And it wasn't until later where we realized, why would we do such a thing? Why would I teach them that they have to hug and kiss, an adult, and when they don't feel like it, we need them to know that their bodies belong to them. So that goes hand in hand with those first discussions of my body is amazing and I'm worth protecting. So that's kind of the, you know, I'm my body is amazing, I'm worth protecting, and here's what good touch and bad touch looks like. Here's what appropriate affection looks like. And so that's a great starting place. Then you can kind of move into instincts, you know, helping our children understand, you know, what are our instincts and how do they keep us safe? What is that icky feeling I might get when somebody is making me uncomfortable or touching me in a way that I am not comfortable with? Helping them, you know, really pinpoint that. Another important thing is to teach them when is it okay to say no and how do we do that? Helping them even practice. I have two very introverted children and one very extroverted child, and I needed my introverts to know that they could say no to certain adults. They couldn't maybe say no to me when I asked them to do their chores, but there's certain opportunities when it's okay to say no, and teaching them when are those times. So that again, and again, people sometimes don't think of that, but that is part of the sex talk, is having those basic foundational things. Something else important for little children is to understand their anatomy, to know the proper names and to know what is the function of my penis, what is the function of my vagina, of my anus, and being very comfortable saying that. I've heard, I don't know how many stories, usually from adults our age, from women who had no idea that their vagina and their urethra was something different. Right? They didn't know that. They weren't taught that. Mom and dad, that was too much to talk about, right? So helping little girls understand you have two different, you know, pieces of anatomy down there. You have a clitoris, you know, and that might be for later, but that's again, that is up to you, the parent, to decide when are you gonna, you know, when to talk about these and to give them as much information as honestly as possible. Another important thing is, again, because we're building those foundational blocks, is to talk about healthy relationships. To talk about, again, even with a 3 and 4 year old, you know, you might think it's a conversation about we don't hit and we don't bite, but those are the building blocks of a healthy relationship later, right? We don't call names. We don't let somebody call us names. These are small, simple things, but that's how we talk with little children so that they understand, that's right, you don't talk to me that way. And I'm going to respect you enough to not talk to you that way, you know. And so again, these are all building blocks for those future conversations. Well, sometimes it is going to be like off the cuff, like you said. I think every parent has had it happen, and whether you like it or not, it's going to happen. They're going to ask you a question that you did not prep for, that you did not create a plan for. So using everyday opportunities like bath time or like going to the doctors. I have been very lucky to have, I've had two different pediatricians who have, like, with my child and me there saying, I'm going to look at this body part, and it's only okay because your parent is right here in the room. And then that helped me have another conversation with that small child later on. Like, did you see how that happened? This is how this works. You know, that it's okay for the doctor to look at you because I am here, you know. I think this back to school time is a great opportunity to talk. These fall months are a great opportunity to talk about, like, what is okay to do, you know, you know, with a teacher. Is it okay for a teacher to touch me like this? Maybe not. Is it okay for this? Is a pat on the shoulder okay? You know, talking about, you know, using the beginning of the school year. Sometimes in the summertime, using that time as another opportunity to talk about public versus private. A lot of us are going on vacations. We're in new locations. We're on a beach. We're going away for the winter. You know, why do we wear certain clothes in the winter? Why do we wear certain clothes in the summer? Even talking about the protective nature of our clothing. You know, why are we going to go ahead and cover up certain parts of our body? That is a great opportunity when we're close shopping, when we're buying a bathing suit, when we're buying swim trunks. These are all great opportunities. I would say a lot of conversations are going to happen. You know, you're driving to soccer practice and your child's going to say, "Why is that person wearing such and such?" I've had that happen with all three of my kids. They saw a billboard. They saw something at the mall. We've all walked past Victoria's Secret and seen our little boys and our little girls.
What is that?
What is going on there? Like, why is she dressed like that? What's that look on her face mean, right? And so you have, that's a great opportunity. Don't be freaked out. Don't let that mean that you have to always walk away from that part of the mall. Use that as an opportunity to talk about your values, which, you know, what you, your expectations in your home. But again, plan some of these conversations. If you know your child is going to a babysitter, if you are going to church, if you are going to school, prepare your children for what is out there. Those are those times that we need to plan ahead, that we need to go ahead and sit down. Maybe it's not going to be the bath time is the perfect opportunity, right? Mm-hmm. We're not always going to have such a perfect opportunity. Sometimes we are going to have to sit down and go, okay, I haven't even discussed this. We don't even have a trip planned, but I'm going to go ahead and talk about with my child that, hey, they never have to hug or kiss anybody that they are not comfortable with. I'm just going to sit them down and we are going to talk about something. Mm-hmm. Having a little plan, talking about that with your partner first, hopefully, but also using the news. That is something that has been very helpful in my life, especially this last year. In an election year, they bring up every topic in the world, it seems like, on the radio, on television. Use those opportunities. Go ahead and pause the television or turn it off. Use that time. I had not spoken about abortion very much with my children until this year. My daughter is in high school, and I had realized that's a topic that I had not really discussed. It was discussed much more when I was a child because it was on the news so much more. It was such a hot button topic. So we talked about that a lot more. For our generation with our children, we're going to see a lot of instances to talk about sexual identification and transgenderism. Those are stories that are popping up all the time, and those are things that my kids have asked multiple questions, and you're going to have that too. All of us are going to have that. If we haven't already, use what's going on in the news, what's going on all around them, to have a discussion. This is a very, very critical age. So this research backs this up. This is when kids are really forming their ideas of not just what sex is, but how they are going to relate to the world sexually, their sexual identification. This is when that 8 to 11 to 12 and 13 a little bit is when we really start figuring out, who am I sexually? That freaks parents out, but again, it really shouldn't, because we can do this simply. You know, it does not have to be one gigantic conversation. You can, again, start with some of that protective information. That's always worth repeating, because we forget. You know, there are many topics that I have heard that we have to repeat. You know, I did not learn how to tie my shoes in one time. I had to practice tying my shoes many, many times before I got that skill down. It's the same thing when we potty train our children. It's the same thing when they learn to make a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. They're not going to get it perfect the first time. So same thing when we're talking about that protective information, it's worth repeating, helping them understand, what does a predator look like? What is good touch, bad touch again? Particularly since most of us are usually in denial of the fact that predators are the people we know. Mm-hmm. They're not the stranger. They're not the person at the mall. They're not someone lurking in the bathroom. 90% of sexual abuse happens from people we know, from friends, from family members. So helping them understand that, and especially as they get into this age group and that teens, helping them understand that predators now can also be peers. So they can be kids we know, older kids we know as well. So that's kind of like, again, a place always that's worth revisiting. Also really important, obviously, is at this point, if they haven't already understood that by maybe age 6 or 7, if you haven't had those discussions, having them fully understand the mechanics of sex. How does sex look? Not how does it look, but you know, like what, yeah. like that
but
they
what
understand.
Does it, what is it really?
Yeah, that they understand that. Now, again, most a lot of parents are leery of this, but because they're what they're going to be exposed to in pornography, I make the suggestion of not having them just understand vaginal sex, but understanding oral and anal sex. And I know that many parents are shocked by that. But again, that is what the majority of pornography is. And again, most kids are exposed to pornography by age 11. And so they are going to be seeing a lot of anal sex and a lot of oral sex. They need to understand from you first what that means before they see it in a basically a disgusting, sometimes simulated rape simulation in what is going on in pornography. So they need to understand from you what that means. What is vaginal sex? What is oral sex? What is anal sex? Something else we need to talk about that's really important is, again, focusing on that intimacy and healthy relationships. They should start understanding what a healthy relationship looks like. What do I want in a mate? What do I want in a partner? What kind of partner am I going to be? You know, like helping them understand that like attracts like, helping them understand the difference between friendships and romantic relationships. This is where some of them might start going, oh, I have a crush on so-and-so. Helping them explore those feelings. Those are very new feelings. And we forget that because we maybe by the time we're a parent, we had maybe 10 crushes throughout middle school and high school. And we have forgotten what those new feelings were like. And what are we supposed to do with those feelings? Helping our kids kind of navigate that minefield. And again, things that I know parents don't want to talk about, but they need to at this age, masturbation and sexual identification. Helping them understand what it means to be gay, what it means to be a lesbian, what it means to be straight. We need to help our kids understand that. You know, and again, parents are worried about these, but they're usually worried for different reasons. And I think the best way to approach this is just with compassion and love, and always thinking about, we don't, you know, you may not think you know, oh, that you may think you know 100% that your child is straight, but we really don't know. And so we need to ask ourselves, how do I want my child to feel? Do I want my child to suffer in silence because I haven't been accepting and loving? Or do I want them to come and maybe I want to be the first to know if those are their feelings? So that's kind of, I think, a way of thinking that we need to be a little more sensitive to and kind of just having that bigger picture. I have several times asked my gay friends, how do you wish your parents had handled this? And it is a very different spectrum of what I had thought, you know, and because most of them can barely even answer that question because it was received so negatively from their parents. They're like, my mother just started crying her head off. My parents were so shocked. I don't want to be that parent. Mm-hmm. So kind of as we approach these topics, just with real kindness, with really paying attention to each of our children's needs. If you have more than one child, some of these discussions are worth doing one-on-one. Mm-hmm. Sometimes these topics can be done as a group. Talking about healthy relationships, talking about intimacy, that's a great group discussion. But when we're talking perhaps about something more critical, like sexual identification or masturbation, those are worth having on an individual basis. Mm-hmm. And of course, puberty, you know, this is again where if you haven't already started those discussions of helping them know, hey, your body is going to change.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I've found, especially with the 7, 8-year-olds, like you said, that's a great place to start. Your body is going to start changing. You're going to notice other kids, their bodies are changing. I mean, that's a very natural place to start. And then yeah. I love that you're, and then of course, as you progress from that, you get into some of these deeper topics, like you were talking about, that, like you said, people sometimes don't think about. They're like, oh, that's about other things. You know, that's just something that we don't even get to. But yeah, we need to get to these things. And I love that you're talking about it in a matter-of-fact, straightforward way. These are all topics that we do need to have a conversation with our children about. And, of course, we want to lay our own values on that to some degree, right? The things that we feel are important, the things that we've experienced. And I think a lot of parents really struggle with that, especially when we get to this age range where we're talking more specifically about sexuality and about kinds of sexual activities that we feel are wonderful or less wonderful or whatever. You know, I think some parents really think, well, you know, this is what I think and this is what I've seen, but is it okay for me to tell my child that this is okay and this isn't okay? Or am I supposed to just give them the information and leave it at that.
And
So
that's
what do
why
you
I
do?
think in our books everything is very open-ended, and it's done on purpose. And we have criticism from both sides in our books. They're people think they're too liberal, people think they're too conservative. But those are topics that we say, well, what do you think? Like when it comes to masturbation, if the parent poses the question to the child, like, well, what do you think? Is this healthy or is this not healthy? And just letting the child lead that conversation. It can be the same thing with talking about topics of sexual identification. Like, well, what have you heard? What are your feelings? Have you had any friends talking about this yet? Because again, we want to just let them share their feelings on that. Again, because what they have been exposed to at school, in the media, is very different than what we were taught. And so it's always really good to just get, a little taste of what they think first before, but definitely share your personal values and your cultural values on that. And speaking of that too, we need to talk, and something that is one of our sex books are probably one of the few that talk about social media and sexting, even at that younger age. Because again, so many parents are giving phones to preteens. You need to address that. It is becoming an epidemic. And most of us don't realize, and it's not just in the schools, it is coming to our congregations as well. Most people don't realize that. I spoke to a conference where, with pastors, and they were like deer in the headlights. And I was like, this is, we again, that's one of those things that we want to think of that's happening somewhere else. And it's
No,
like,
it's happening
absolutely
everywhere.
not. It's happening. The pressure is on all of our daughters, and that same double standard that exists for everything else. We often attack the girl for sending photos, but we don't go after the boy who asked for them, and so that is a great conversation in itself for preteens and teens, is that the double standard, and how that is being applied right on when it comes to social media and sexting and apps and phone use, that it's rampant. And that's something that I know, again, parents, we want to check off. That is something that we revisit with our children probably more than anything, is social media and apps, because that they are changing so frequently. They are so much a part of our lives, especially for teenagers. We have to be on top of those things and have to revisit that conversation very frequently. Absolutely. And one of the principles that we bring up in our book, we call it the safe zone, where a child can say, I want to be in the safe zone. And that is where they can talk or ask you any question, or maybe even tell you something that's going on in their life with no repercussions, so that they can ask you anything. Because that honestly is the ultimate goal. That's one of the ultimate goals of these books, is that I want my children, that's what I've wanted from the beginning, is I want my children to know they can talk to me about anything. And so that is the meaning of the safe zone. So I love the idea of having it on Sunday night. Ours is usually at the dinner or right after dinner. But I also have had different experiences. I have lots of friends who've had the experience of laying down in bed with their kids, or they read them a story, or they're just sitting there on the edge of the bed chatting, but they know that that's their time. That's kind of like, we're relaxed. Everything is done for the day, and it really, that's a great opportunity too, to just kind of like open the discussion or to bring up a simple question. And it doesn't always have to be a sex question. Maybe it's a question about intimacy. Maybe it's a question about what they want to be when they grow up. Whatever, you can start just with anything. But again, having that pattern of an open time where they know, like, generally that's when they can come and talk to mom or come and talk to dad. That's critical. And I think that's one of those habits. They've done tons of research on showing how having dinner together is important. It's certainly not about eating food together, right? It's about the conversation that ensues. And I'm sure if they did research on Sunday nights, if we had thousands of families that participated in a Sunday where Sunday night they knew they had that from 7 to 8 o'clock at night to talk to mom or dad, that would be a phenomenal experience for those families. So any kind of pattern that we can set with our kids of, this is a time to ask mom, where I know mom is going to be relaxed and open and not worried about her work or her job or getting, chores or homework done, that is a great thing. We as an organization, we laugh and we are saddened by the fact that our 12 plus books are our least selling books of the three. We have, the age 3 to 7, we have the 8 to 11, and the 12 plus. But that is because so many parents think they're done with these conversations. And it's really sad because we're like, this is where the good stuff comes in. This is where we're not just talking about puberty and anatomy. This is where we get to talk about the amazingness about sex. This is where we can really share with a child who understands emotional intimacy. We can talk about how sex can be this connecting, bonding, fun experience. It's where we can talk about orgasm. I mean, you can talk about it with a younger child, but honestly, that 12 plus range, they really have a better understanding. They can understand concepts that maybe they haven't experienced, but a little bit better, but they can kind of see that bigger picture where you can talk about body image a little bit more, also with a younger age, but you can talk about the effects of body image. You can talk about what happens when we mix alcohol with sex. You can talk about the positive and the negative aspects of sex. So that is a time for just so many different topics. One of the big topics that we focus on in the book is consent. We need to, our kids, our boys and our girls need to have a very clear understanding. What is consent? What does it mean when I've given consent? What does it mean when I have understood that somebody else has given their consent? So that's a big topic that there's a lot of confusion for teenagers, especially the, with people and kids, especially mixing alcohol and drugs with sex. That is a topic, and that is, again, this has been a year that I have talked about that more than ever with my kids because there has been so many news stories about college rape and the lack of enforcing laws and the lack of putting people and people not going to jail for their crimes. And so we've talked about that a lot. But we talk again about predators. We talk again about the double standard. We talk about sexting and social media even more critically because now your kids are going to be able to come back to you. They will have stories. They will have this. Now it's not just you sharing the stories from what you've seen on the news. It's them sharing the stories of what's going on at school. Again, my daughter is a sophomore. I mean, it was already last year as a freshman. Several of her girlfriends from different schools, the pressure was on to send naked or near nude photos. And to me, that's a very young age. To basically be asked for child pornography, to create your own child pornography. And but it is happening more and more. And we find the research is showing that when one girl in a group starts, the other girls tend to follow. So that is again why it is so critical to talk about what are the effects. Our lives are being lived so much in that digital realm, especially our teenagers, that they have got to understand what it means when they put stuff out on social media, whether that's even if that's a healthy a social media that you use. Maybe it's Instagram, maybe it's Facebook, these things that can be so innocent, but that also can be a platform not just for sexual activity, but for bullying. So helping them, understand that picture. And that is something that, like I said, we have had to revisit many, many times in our family. And when I talk with other parents, every parent has a story of where they dropped the ball. This is something that's so new for us, those of us who have teenagers. It's happening so quickly that this is one I would say you cannot talk enough about. You cannot talk enough about what they are doing on their phones, and you cannot know enough about what's going on in their lives. That you should know who their friends are socially, that you should know what their habits, you should know what types of texts, even if you're not reading every single text, you should know what type of digital citizen your child is. What is the energy they're giving out? What are their friends saying back to them, either in text or on social media, so that you have an understanding of what is going on in their lives? And obviously, in all three of the books, we have discussions of pornography, even for that 3 to 7, that 8 to 11, and that 12 plus. But all three of those are critical in all three of those age groups is to talk about the dangers of pornography. Like I said before, the average age of exposure is 11. A lot of kids in that middle school, that is when it's on the bus, it's at a friend's phone, it's on their own phone. And most people think, oh, I put a filter on, so I'm done with that conversation. No, everybody I know has a filter, and everybody I know, their child has still been exposed somewhere. Your child is going to be exposed. Your child is going to be curious, and we need to address that, helping them understand that their curiosity is very natural and very normal, but that there is an industry that is targeting them, that wants their dollars, wants them to become addicted, wants them to get into this so that they have future clients for the next 100 years, right? They are targeting our kids with, whether they're, through different pop-ups, through doing, our kids are going to
It's
be exposed
everywhere.
at so many different places that's a conversation that goes hand in hand with what they're doing on social media and on their phones to keep that dialogue going. But absolutely, your child should have a plan. That's why we talk about it at a very young age so that they can know, okay, this is going to happen. Now, what do I do? Is it going to be at my friend's house? What am I going to say to that friend who shows that to me? And most importantly, is why? Why do we want to avoid this?
The
It's the
big
same thing.
why.
The big why, and a lot of people talk about the addiction factor. If that's what you're comfortable talking about, go for it. My focus is always about, again, seeing that it's an unhealthy, unnatural view of sexuality, that it's fake, that it's counterfeit, and most importantly, that this is continual violent depictions of women in a position of powerlessness. That was a discussion that we had this summer with my kids because, my daughter, one of her guy friends had said to her, well, it's not always violent. And so we had that, and I said, well, let's talk about what violence is. And I said, is spitting on a woman violent? And that took them, and we had that discussion. I said, is name calling violent? Yes, is, because these are things that happen in pornography. Something, there is much worse. There are things that they don't, that I don't want to be too graphic on this, but there are things that are done that are, maybe it's not hitting and slapping, but it is to me just as violent and so degrading to a woman that what they that it's to me it is violence. It is absolute hate speech against women, and that is something that we have got to talk about with our kids. That to me is the why. This is why we avoid it. We do not want those images in our head. We do not want that tainting our view of sexuality, of what I think is sexy or what I think I want to have in my future sex life. So this is the why of avoiding pornography and helping our boys and our girls understand this is why it's a dangerous thing for us.
Well, and I love that all of your books really do focus on asking the questions to your kids so that they can develop their own why. Because I know as a parent, when it comes to explaining why the kids need to wipe off the table after dinner or why they need to clean up their room, that's somewhat helpful if I explain the why. But if I turn it around to them and I say, "Why do you think that I'm asking you to clean your room?" Or why do you think, whatever it might be, whether you're talking about regular life or whether you're talking about your sexuality and your sex life and the things that are appropriate or inappropriate, that same thing, same principle, right? If your
Absolutely.
kids can own that why, it's going to make so much difference for them,
Absolutely.
right?
Absolutely. From every piece of this, why do we wear clothes that cover our private areas? Why do we, why am I going to wait until I am in a committed relationship with somebody who loves me? Why do we never mix alcohol with sex? Why do we avoid pornography? Why do we come and tell mom, why is it that you can tell mom anything? Again, just continually having that why discussion. That's critical to them so that they, yes, that they can own it, that they can know that they can internalize that as, that's right. Okay, that is why this is so important. This isn't just mom and dad saying no. This is understanding. This is the big picture. This is how important and critical a sexual relationship is. It's not something you take and throw away. Sex is not something you take. Why is that? Why is it about giving? And that is why we're always, again, focusing on that intimacy. What is that big picture? That this is, sex is not the only piece of the relationship, but it's this amazing reflection of the rest of the healthy relationship. And so that's why we have 30 topics. That's why it is 30 days of sex talks. People, when they sometimes have seen the book, they're like, I don't want to talk about that for 30 days. And then you're like, but then they open it up and go, oh, okay, yeah, I get it. I get that big picture. Or, oh, okay, yeah, that would be interesting to talk about. Or, yeah, I want to talk about, healthy relationships with my kids. That's a great topic then, so helping the big picture, the why. The pressure is on all of our daughters, you know, and that same double standard that exists for everything else. We often attack the girl for sending photos, but we don't go after the boy who asked for them, you know? And so that is a great conversation in itself for preteens and teens, is that the double standard, you know, and how that is being applied right on when it comes to social media and sexting and apps and phone use, that it's, you know, it's rampant. And that's something that I know, again, parents, we want to check off. That is something that we revisit with our children probably more than anything is social media and apps, because that they are changing so frequently. They are so much a part of our lives, especially for teenagers. We have to be on top of those things and have to revisit that conversation very frequently. So we are at www.educateempowerkids.org. There's a link right there for the books, but the books are also on Amazon. And the books are called 30 Days of Sex Talks, Empowering Your Child with Knowledge of Sexual Intimacy. So we have an age 3 to 7, an 8 to 11, and a 12 plus. We also have 30 Days to a Stronger Child. And this is about filling our accounts, about filling our emotional, our spiritual, our intellectual, and our physical accounts. And then we also have How to Talk to Your Kids About Pornography. All of these have very simple, lots of discussion questions. The Stronger Child book has tons of activities as well to incorporate. They're a great family night activity. We also, on the website, we have on our resources page tons of downloadable lessons that you can just download for free and look at. There's lots of articles. You can look in the search for, we're in the process of redoing the website. That'll probably be up in January. So that'll look a little cleaner, a little more, little fresher look to it. But I think even now we also have Spanish resources. If you have Spanish speaking friends, the How to Talk to Your Kids About Pornography is now available in Spanish. And we are also working on the 30 Days of Sex Talks, making those available in Spanish in the future. We also just redid our Kindle versions of the Sex Talks. And so those have, you know, stronger links, a few more resources in them. So we just redid those. So all awesome. New, great stuff.
So just a little bit more about how the books actually work. Because like you mentioned, when I first saw these books, I thought, wait, I'm supposed to sit down and talk to my kids about sex every day for 30 days? So what does that actually mean?
It means you can do it in 30 days if you want. Like, especially I think the younger topics, they're so simple. I want parents to be able to open the book, look at it for 5 minutes and give the lesson. To me, it should be that simple. It should not, it should feel, that's why I said 30 days. I'm like, you really could do it in 30 days if you wanted to. But most of us, we want to spread this out. We want to get kids to
think like
about
this.
Do
like one a week or something.
One a week is absolutely the best. I think that's perfect. But it's also a resource that you can come back to. We have a really great glossary in there with tons of terminology that if you're struggling to find the words, if you're struggling, how do I actually discuss or say what anal sex is? Well, we have a great simple definition for you that you can start with. So there's a great glossary in there. We actually, most people don't realize, there is a QR code for downloadable cards in every book. And you can download the cards and then have the cards and use it for little kids. They love this because then it's almost like a game. It's something very simple that has just some of the bullets. You can also use those cards when you download them. You can just to stick it on the fridge as a reminder for you. That's right. I need to talk about private versus public today, or I'm going to talk about body image today. So there's the downloadable cards that are in there as well.
Oh, that's so great. All these different resources so that this all goes back to the third question we talked about, is overcoming that trepidation and that fear. I know when you have something physical that you can read through that'll give you some verbiage that will tell you some methods, it's so much easier and so much of the fear goes away. That goes for any subject in our life, right?
Absolutely.
Given the training and the information, it's not as scary.
Yeah,
right?
And that's all I want for people. When I go and I speak, that is my main focus, is I want people to leave here, and I hope people leave from this discussion going, I can do this. They should open our books and look at it and go, this is easy, I can do this. That is what I want. I don't want anyone to open our books and go, I can't do this. I don't want them to feel overwhelmed. I have been there. I've been scared. I've been overwhelmed before. And I don't want anyone to have that feeling. I want people to look and go, oh my goodness, it's this simple? Yes, it really is this simple. You can do this.